We're gonna go to the beach. Here's my boyky. That's a good dog. Come on. That's a good boy. Shake. There you go. This morning we're down on the shore in Table Bay. We're looking at one of the most important species that occur on rocky shores, both in South Africa and in temperate regions around the world, and that is mussels. So you can see that the shore here is completely covered with a coating of mussel shells. And mussels are bivalve molluscs. So they're related to snails, but instead of having a single coiled shell, they have two shell valves. So each mussel has got a left-hand shell and a right-hand shell, and they're hinged at the back of the mussel here so that they can gape and close again. And all mussels are filter feeders. In the inside of the mussel, it has a very large gill that's a bit like a netting curtain that hangs vertically down the center of the mussel. And there are two openings at the posterior end, so that's the broad end here. An opening through which the water is sucked in, it's called the inhalent siphon, and then another opening above it through which the water is squirted out, that's called the exhalent siphon. So the mussel sucks water in through the one siphon, which you can recognize because it has little fringes around the edge of it to keep particles that are too large out. And then it filters that water through the gill. It pumps the water through this netting curtain, and all the little food particles are extracted onto that curtain. And then the beautifully clean water is pumped out of the exhalent siphon. So mussels are extremely efficient filterers. So each individual mussel like this will filter maybe 2 liters of water an hour. And through that water, it will extract any particle larger than a couple of microns. That's a couple of thousandths of a millimeter. So the water that they pump out is beautifully clean. You can actually use mussels like this to filter the water. I mean, you could, if you had a saltwater swimming pool, you could have a bunch of mussels in there. And if you have a seawater aquarium, if you just have a few mussels in it, it keeps the water crystal clear. On a mussel bed like this, you can easily have 1,000 mussels on a square meter. So if each of those 1,000 mussels is filtering 2 liters of water an hour, that's 2 cubic meters of water an hour. In other words, if the water was 2 meters deep above this mussel bed, the mussels would be filtering all that water and extracting all the particles larger than 2 microns every hour. So they keep the water beautifully clear.
So what are they getting out of the water? Is it just little bits of plant matter? Are they eating everything?
Yes, they eat everything that's in the water. They're not particularly fussy. So they eat phytoplankton cells. That's the main food item. But the water is also full of little particles of dead organic matter that have worn off the ends of kelp fronds or bits of seaweed. And anything that's of the right size and is organic is filtered out. And they can survive on remarkably little food. So each one of those liters of water typically has only 2, 3, 4 milligrams of particulate matter in it. So that's the equivalent of 2 or 3 grams in a cubic meter of water. So they're filtering a cubic meter of water to get just 2 grams of material out of it, and they're totally happy on that. In fact,
sounds like hard work.
Yeah, it is like hard work. If there's much more than that, they actually can't cope with it and they actually close down.
I've noticed that some of them have got like rings on them. They look like they've got tree rings.
Yes.
They're building their shell each year.
That's exactly right. Yeah. So mussels are growing from the base here, and each year they lay down additional shell along this growing edge here. And so if the site is seasonal, if there's a growing season and a non-growing season, then you get distinct growth rings in the shell and you can age it. Here in South Africa, it's not so obvious. In more temperate countries, you can count the growth rings very easily and you can age the mussels.
Can we just talk a little bit about them as a food source? I mean, do we farm mussels or are we picking them off?
Yes, I mean, there's two aspects to the food source component of mussels. They are the forage organisms of the seashore. So they're kind of the grass of the Serengeti. So many of the animals that live here feed on these mussels. So birds will come, like oyster catchers, and feed on them. Starfish feed on them. Crabs feed on them. Drilling whelks feed on them. And then they fall off from these rocks too into the sea anemones, these dense beds of sea anemones that are all around my feet here. And they also feed on them. So this is all yesterday's dinner being pushed out here. So many of the predators on the seashore are feeding on mussels. They are the kind of forage organism. And they're also, of course, very important in human nutrition. So we farm mussels, and it's not a big thing in South Africa, but worldwide, millions of tons of mussels are grown for human consumption.
And just to be clear, you can't just come down and like pluck the mussels off of the rocks. You have to have a permit for that.
Yes, yes. You have to have a permit, and that entitles you to collect 30 mussels a day. But they are good eating. And environmentally, they're a very good thing as well, because they're very low down in the food chain. And if you compare eating cattle, for example, to eating mussels, mussels are cold-blooded, so they don't waste a lot of energy on metabolism. And as a result, they turn a lot of the food that they eat into mussel flesh. So the conversion efficiency, as ecologists call it, the amount of food that's turned into meat, is about 30% for a mussel. And it'll only be 5 or 10% for a cow or a sheep. So they're very efficient. And you don't have to feed them if you're farming them. You just put them in the water, and they just filter the water and clarify it. And there you go, you get your food quickly. So a mussel like this, which is a nice eating size, would be maybe 1 to 2 years old.
Oh, okay.
So they grow quite quickly.
Fast growth.
They grow to 60 or 70 millimeters in the first year.
Cool.
An interesting thing about mussels too is that most of the body of the mussels, most of the flesh of the mussels, is actually gonad. So when you eat mussels, you're basically eating gonad.
Reproductive organs.
Reproductive organs, yeah. So 50 to 70% of the weight of the mussel is gonad. And they produce, when they spawn, they produce millions and millions of eggs, up to 6 million eggs per mussel.
Wow.
And they drop their weight by over 50%. So the mussel's nice and big and fat one day, and then it spawns, and then the next day it's all thin and shriveled up, and there's not much to eat in it. So I've had lots of entertaining conversations with students about this, and comparing what it would be like if we were like that. So you know, you go to a nice party on Saturday night, all fat and plump, and then on Sunday morning you come home, you're all thin and shriveled, and your friends will say to you, "Oh, I see you had a good party last night."
They give a new meaning to the walk of shame.
Yes, that's right. And the other interesting thing about the spawning is that when one mussel spawns, then there are hormones in those eggs and sperm, and they stimulate all the other remaining ones around to spawn at the same time. So you have a mass spawning. And again, if you put that in human terms, you know, you could be in the stadium watching the rugby match, and if somebody spawned, then everybody else would go off.
You can put this in an episode.
So, you know, the pilot of your aeroplane might be like, "Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our flight." And in the unlikely event of a mass spawning, this aeroplane is equipped with drainage channels here, here, and here. Please remain seated.
I can see you've had lots of these conversations.
Yeah. So it's quite an amazing thought, actually. So 1 square meter of mussels can actually spawn 27 kilograms of sperm and eggs each year.
Sure.
It's a calculation that we made. So they can spawn 2 or 3 times in the year, and you can easily have like 20 kilograms of mussels on a square meter of rock like this.
I guess that explains why they manage to be so abundant, even though everybody's eating them.
And then there's millions of eggs floating around in the water. The sperm fertilizes them. And so you've got a huge number, billions of larvae in the water at spawning time. And then those can float quite large distances. They can float 100 kilometers from where they were spawned, and then they'll find the rock and settle on it. And they settle at enormous densities. their satellite densities of hundreds of thousands per square meter. And then as they grow, just geometrically, you can't fit that number of larger mussels onto a rock. So you'll start with 100,000, you know, that are a millimeter long, and then a year later, they're going to be this long, and then you can only fit 1,000 on. So there's like an inevitable 99% mortality. So biologists call this self-thinning. So if we can actually look at some of these rocks here, here's a patch which is fairly recently settled. Here we've got some very young mussels that are probably only a month or two old, and the density is tens of thousands per square meter. Here we've got some older ones here which are now starting to grow and starting to force themselves off the rock and forming these hummocks here, which are actually quite unstable. Yeah. So many of these individuals will get washed away during the next storm. Look how loose this is here. So that'll come off in the next storm. And so they're fighting for the rock space. The weaker ones are getting pushed off, and you sort of maintain 100% cover, but the numbers will drop from 100,000 to about 1,000 when they're adult. So they, you know, life is short and tough if you're a mussel. It's like a 1% probability that you'll make it to the age of one. You see they're attached to the rock by these golden threads here. They're called Bissell threads, or the beard is the kind of common name. And those are actually individually laid down by the foot of the mussel. It has a foot which is like a locomotory organ, a long tongue-like organ that it uses to pull itself around. They can move when they're small. And then when it wants to attach itself to the rock, then it extends the foot. And then on the underside of the foot, there's a little channel, and it runs liquid glue into this channel, and then till it gets to the end and forms a little puddle on the rock, and then it holds its foot in place for a few minutes, and the glue hardens, and then it removes the foot, and then there's one thread or one guy rope that's been attached. Then it moves its foot to a different location, runs the glue along the groove again, holds it for 10 or 15 minutes, removes its foot, and then it's got a second guy rope. So over a period of a day or so, it'll lay out a whole ring of those guy ropes, and that attaches it very firmly to the rock. So that's what you're seeing here. You've got a ring of maybe 100 of these individual guy ropes. So these Bissell threads are actually extremely strong, and in the ancient world, they actually collected the Bissell threads of larger species of mussel and use them to weave material, like cloaks that people wore in battle to protect themselves from arrows and swords. So Jason's golden cloak, which is in Greek mythology, yeah, is supposedly made from the Bissell threads of mussels, wow, which have this beautiful golden color. Yeah,
that would make sense. Excuse you, Ben. Yeah. Crossing camera.
I'll just start again then.